fact, I really just really believe in group therapy. And so I have some things I want to get off my chest and talk about some things. And so I trust all of you because I love all of you. So I'm going to tell you the story about how I fell in love with a stick from Wisconsin. Last year I had the privilege of being selected as a parent ambassador for orientation. And so I met a lot of great people. And so I'm just going to start at the beginning of my friendship with someone. I walked into this room for our orientation, like, intro, right? And so I met a lot of people. There was, like, sorority girls with, like, preppy stuff and, like, some weird people who I really don't know. And then, like, there comes in this really handsome young fella. His hair was about the size of, like, Mufasa. And, he could shake it like a two. That sounded sexual. And so I knew from, like, right there that I wanted to be friends with this person. He had this smile that, like, is really toothy, but he can't get it all the way quite up. And so it's just, it's the most adorable thing ever. And so from there, I, you know, I wanted to see if he was a homosexual. And so I, of course, I added him on Snapchat. I tried, you know, talking to him for a while, sending the cute little, like, oh, I'm just getting into bed, or I'm just waking up. My shirt just happens to be off. It wasn't working, it's fine. But as you know, we saw each other every Tuesday because we had training. That fucking sucked. Yeah. It's really like just sitting there in business casual learning about the university. I love the university full time. So we keep going, and the year goes on, and I get to hang out with him more. We make a lot of our food because, you know, fat asses, you know, that's how that happens. And so, every Tuesday after training, or almost every Tuesday, we would end up going get food together. It was at Lakeside because the bitch is poor. you know how it is. And so I meet him every day and we hang out. And then we go to move in this for the summer to work for orientation. It's hot as hell. It's Alabama. But my room ends up not being able to be moved in with. So I had to get switched to another room. And it just so happens, as fate does, I'm his roommate for the whole summer. With, like, two other great people. I love the two other guys. I'm like, you know, I have my mind set. I still have hope. There's Midwestern boys that get you every time. And so we spent the whole summer together. We're waking up at 5 a.m. Him waking up 2 seconds after me because he tries to get the shower before me, but never works. And we're walking into the park every morning. Somehow he keeps this smile on his face every single day, and it is the most adorable thing you've ever seen. The whole summer I get to see him flirt with these random girls that come to Bama Bound. I see these old women coming in, sending their children off to college, and flirting with a 20-year-old who is on stage. And there is not a single woman in that crowd who would not fall for Travis. It's kind of weird, actually. The old ladies would kind of go after Travis, yeah. But summer went on, and we, you know, continued to be best friends. And then we get towards the end of the summer, and of course, everyone's so emotional. We had spent this whole, you know, semester together, serving university, helping some of the lovely freshmen who are in this room come to Bama Bound. You know, it's awesome. I'm glad to have you. But as towards the end of the summer, we have these wonderful, like, meetings and, like, banquets to celebrate the end of the summer. People get awards. People, you know, show each other love. But for some godforsaken reason, our boss wanted us to go around and tell a story of the summer. And everyone starts getting emotional, of course. We're planning on, you know, just, you know, dipping out because we've been up since 5 a.m. But nope. So, you know, I tell the story about how I had never had any sort of relationship with a guy outside of, you know, a relationship. I didn't know how to interact with the straights. summer with them, I was able to experience, you know, people in a whole different way. I'm there at the university trying to showcase people and showcase how amazing each and every one of the students here at the university are. And the whole time I'm being shown how I can develop myself, and I'm being shown how to change my life, honestly. I told this story that one day my sister illegally brought a cat into the residence hall. And like, as an RA, you know, I'm like, but I wanted the cat, so. And it's still my lock, it's still my iPhone like background to this day. It's great. Her name is Lemon. She's cute, fluffy. But he was on his, it was just after a break that we had orientation. So he was on his way back from Ireland, because that's where white people go. But he was on his way back, and I was Snapchatting him, and he saw the cat, and he literally got from Barbie Cam in 45 minutes just to see a cat. He walked in and started petting the cat, and it's the most tender moment that I have ever seen with anyone, and that was the moment where I knew I was in love with this boy. Aww. And falling in love with straight people isn't fun.
Amen.
Semester. We see each other almost every day. His apartment and his roommates are just the greatest guys I've ever met. Continued the whole developing how to interact with the straight men, I guess. And so I got to see him more. We took, you know, lots of cute little pictures. Me with a full face of makeup, him just getting out of bed. You know, cute pictures. And our friendship became even better. We had a long-ass streak. We talked to each other every day, FaceTime at night. It was like having a relationship, except he's straight. And then this beginning of this semester, he messaged me to come pick him up from the airport. But as an RA, I have to have training at the beginning of each semester. It's annoying as hell, might I add, but I have to go through it. And I tell him I can't. I have to stay at training. And then he says, that's fine. You know, he's not going to let anything get him down whatsoever. So we're like, I'm going to go pick you up on Tuesday. We'll go eat Pho Town because he, for some reason, loves Asian food and Asian culture, which why I was like, it means he loves me, right? But then Monday morning, I get a direct message from someone else who's on the team. Someone I've never spoken to, who said, hey, can I come talk to you for a minute? So he drops all the way across campus and tells me that Travis passed away about 4 hours after he got home from the airport, where I was supposed to pick him up. And so, I didn't know how to react at first. I was pretending I was fine. I was pretending that I could keep going on and doing what he needed to do, because that's how I react to pain. And as soon as I got back in my room, I broke down because I had lost my best friend. I had lost the closest thing I'd ever had to a boyfriend. And I just lost the greatest person in my life. And to thinking that I could have been the last person he had saw, and I was gonna see him the next day, it's something that's gonna haunt me forever. Luckily enough, through some very amazing friends and a very amazing university, I was able to fly home to his funeral. It's Green Bay, Wisconsin. It's fucking cold. When we woke up the day of the funeral in Wisconsin, it was -1 degrees. I'm sitting here with one layer of pants and a sweater, thinking that's going to be fine. It's not. And so we go to his funeral. I'm trying to laugh, trying to distract myself. I play musicals because ABO. And so we get there, and we sign in. We do all the formal things. I can't bring myself to meet his mother. I can't bring myself to even go speak to her. I found every excuse, like, oh, she has a whole line of people, I'll see you later. But I distract myself even more, and I decide I'm going to go see this casket. And that's the worst decision I've ever made. Seeing him, the happiness, the light up from him. I don't understand. I felt this fire in my throat trying to introduce myself to his mother and his sister. I couldn't even bring myself to even talk to her, his sister, the day of. I messaged her through Instagram to talk to her a week afterwards because I was a coward and I couldn't speak to her. And they're Catholic, so that was an hour and a half long service. They knew I was a fat ass, so they had food afterwards. Wisconsin's are fucking weird. They served water and milk. Well, we could be like water and tea, like normal people. They had water and milk. But you know, I still ate. And so we come home, I don't know how, but Wisconsin, you think it would be big. I mean, I have a whole ass football team. So you think it would be like big. So we go into the airport to leave. We're sitting in Green Bay for 3 hours waiting to leave. And I go to buy a shot glass for my dad because he collects shot glasses from every state. And so I travel a lot, so I try to go pick things up for him. And the lady who is my like cashier was like, well, what are you here for? She sees my Alabama license. And she's like, what are you here for? And I'm gonna be like, I'm here because my friend died. But for some reason, I felt like I shouldn't, you know, try to hide that. I should tell people and like talk about it because that's the only way I'm gonna make things better. And she's like, "Oh, I knew him. I was his teacher in kindergarten." And it's like, how in the hell are we gonna be in this moment right now? But when I finally got home and everything happened, I tried to make things better. I tried to make myself feel like I could handle it. I tried talking to friends, but every day I can feel him everywhere. I see him outside of Amy Comer at 11:50 where he's supposed to be after his classes. I feel him when I'm up all night and I can't sleep. And I can feel him sitting there. And I don't know how to tell his mother or any of his family when they come and ask me, hey, did he have a special woman in his life? Hey, what's the password to his phone? Do you know that? I don't want them to open his text or his pictures or anything like that and see anything that might change how they feel about him. I know it's 2018 and people are changing, but there are things that can change the way people see you. And I don't know how people can leave you so fast. I know it's not our decision. I know that he's going to be looking down at me, calling me a little bitch because I'm crying. But I just really wanted to just get him out and talk about these feelings because I don't want to bottle him up and I don't want to continue to be sad. And